What's up, guys? Houndish here, and today we're going to jump in and talk about some Destiny 2 stuff as we come to the end of 2018. So first up, I will round up a bunch of new content and things to be aware of as we go into 2019. We'll talk about game updates and content coming in January, but I also want to speak about upcoming quests in the game, some power level requirements for those so you guys are aware, as well as a couple of other things that you can prepare for. We're also going to round up Bungie updates from over the past week, and we'll take a quick look back at 2018 for Destiny 2, which of course has been a pretty interesting year. So guys, I hope you enjoyed the video, but now let's get into it. First up, I do want to wish you all the best in the new year. I hope you guys have had awesome holidays over the past couple of weeks. We are going to talk about the new year roadmap for the game, but firstly, the Dawning will be ending basically today, so with a reset time on the 1st of January. And of course, you may still have a bunch of Dawning materials. It's definitely worth crafting as many gifts as you can, turning them in for those Masterwork cores. Today will be the last chance to Masterwork Eva's Holiday Oven, all that good stuff, unlock the Triumphs for the Dawning. But primarily, if you've been sleeping on it like I have, definitely create some of those gifts and get some of the materials for it, because of course, the economy for enhanced cores is still pretty harsh in the game. And now some Guardians may be wondering what happens next for Destiny 2. Well, we still have some content to come from the Black Armory. So firstly, Niobe Labs will be launching next week now. Pretty crazy to think, but of course, Niobe Labs launches on the 8th of January. Bungie described this as an event that will ultimately unlock the Fourth Forge, and essentially our path through the final bits of content inside of Black Armory itself. It should also, from what we know, mean the continuation of the Mysterious Box quest, so we should unlock the remaining exotics. But I wanted to point out some stuff about power level requirements for some of the content that's coming up. So first up, via Niobe Labs, we will unlock the Baguzia Forge. This is kind of the master forge for the game, and from what we know, you can craft any weapon frame in this forge. But the thing to note about Baguzia, currently listed in the database, it is a 640 power level forge, and all of the other forges in the game are currently listed at 610 power, and Bungie did make some adjustments to those power levels. So unless, of course, Bungie updates this, you should be aware the Baguzia Forge itself is still listed as 640. It is the final forge, so it makes sense that it would kind of be the endgame forge. But also as part of the Mysterious Box quest, we are going to have to complete a couple of different missions. One of them will be a strike in the Pyramidion. We need to go here and collect Radiant Phase Glass for an unidentified frame, but the power level requirement for this mission, once again, will be 640. So of course, with people being at all different power levels, it's definitely worth bearing in mind some of the content coming up is going to be at the endgame level. And we do have the Last Word quest coming to the game on January 29th. This one, once again, currently has mission content listed at 650 power level. And of course, that is in a few weeks' time, so hopefully this will be useful for you guys who are still leveling up but want to access this content. But considering we've now accessed all of the legendary frames that we know about in the game, you may be wondering what a final forge will actually be used for. And once again, from what we know, you will be able to craft any weapon inside of this forge. Who knows, maybe there'll be a way to complete this forge faster than the other ones, and that might be the reason the Bungie are doing that. But also, Black Armory weapons still have an upgrade node for a visual effect, or what appears to be a visual effect according to the UI. It appears to be a mod that will drop at some point that allows us to add a chroma or a different visual effect, so that, as well as upcoming exotic quests, appear to actually require this forge. Also, in terms of preparation, a credible data mine suggested that the Mysterious Box quest will require us to turn in a Black Armory rare bounty, so if you do get one dropped, it'll probably be worth completing it and holding onto it. As I mentioned, Last Word comes on January 29th, and it appears that we'll also get a major sandbox update alongside this, or at least one of the more major updates that we've had since the launch of Forsaken, where Bungie are talking about exotics like Telesto, as well as certain subclass changes, adjustments to weapons, and heavy ammo. So if a sandbox update is something you've been waiting for, it looks like alongside the Last Word, we'll get a bit of a shakeup right there on January 29th. And that also makes sense because on February 5th, Crimson Days is going to launch. So the event is returning to the game. We don't know a lot about it. It has previously seen a PvP focus, especially with a doubles game mode. That could be different this time around. But if there is a PvP element, then maybe Bungie are trying to create opportunities to experience that new sandbox after the update on the 29th of January. Also, though, it has been quiet in terms of Bungie updates. Next week, as well as the launch of Niobe Labs, Bungie will have their first This Week at Bungie of 2019, and with a few different things going on New Year, it could actually be a pretty decent update. Up next, though, let's speak about some stuff going on in the game this week. So, of course, we did get the new weapon frame for the Striker Surehand Sword. A lot of people have been going for roles of this with Surrounded. Bungie Help tweeted and said, "We're investigating an issue where the perk Surrounded no longer does bonus damage on the Striker Surehand Sword if it has been upgraded to a tier 10 masterwork." So basically right now, make sure you avoid masterworking that sword fully if you do have the Surrounded bonus, as it will stop working. However, folks have actually been using this sword to get some pretty ridiculous DPS. And primarily, people are actually doing this without ammo. And the reason for this is that Surrounded still works without ammo on the sword, but when swords don't have any ammo, many of the melee bonuses, including damage bonuses for various different classes, actually end up benefiting the sword. So KRSTV from Twitch actually recorded a clip right here. And with the top tree Arcstrider melee buff, they're actually able to get 2,500 damage per hit without any ammo in the sword. But you can bump that up even more with Surrounded. And since then, folks have started using all different kinds of melee buffs to do incredible things with this sword. Astacross actually posted a video where they got a 587% increase in damage, and I believe this was combining Bardic Enhancements, and that's with the Syntheseps, and then Surrounded and Surrounded Spec, as well as Knockout, that's a Striker perk with Assassin's Blade on the sword. So basically, the most powerful sword in the game right now is one that has absolutely no ammo in it whatsoever, which is pretty ridiculous. So I'll link that video down below if you want to check it out in more detail. Striker Shorthand has certainly been a pretty interesting weapon so far. Now though, despite the holidays, Bungie did actually drop a quick update. Nothing major, but they're just focusing on vital information and known issues about the game right now. So they are investigating reports where the Ace of Spades Memento Mori perk is cancelling early when reload is initiated. There is also an issue where the legendary version of the Braytech rifle can't be infused above 600 power, and problems where Blast Furnace is losing extra ammo on a trigger pull when using Ambitious Assassin. Bungie are also aware of issues claiming Dawning Triumphs, as well as weapon frame bounties, where players are unable to purchase multiple frame bounties in a week. There are quite a few different issues with weapon frames right now, having them disappear from inventories, or players being locked out from creating multiple frames a week. Bungie do know about that. There is also an issue where radiant matrixes inside of a postmaster can actually be pushed out and become unobtainable. So essentially, if one does go to the postmaster, pick it up as soon as possible. Bungie say they're working on a fix for the issue where players don't receive enhancement cores when hitting Legend in the Crucible. They also confirmed that Nightfall rotations are completely random, so how those are selected week over week is a completely randomized system. And of course, there has been a bit of feedback about certain Nightfalls not coming up for very long periods of time. And that of course kind of sucks if you're trying to collect four different titles or simply acquire the loot from certain strikes. So Bungie are passing along that feedback, and maybe they can intervene and roll out certain Nightfalls that haven't been up for a long time. They're also passing along feedback to bring Glass Needles back into the game. And of course, we used to be able to use these to reroll at Xur, so you could essentially reforge or reroll the stats on exotic armor pieces, as well as the bonuses, and that definitely would be a really good thing in the game right now, especially with the current exotic drop rates. Plus, Xur is also getting an update next season where we get bounties and stuff like that. So feedback about Xur right now is definitely positive, as Bungie essentially works to fix that vendor. So there we go, guys. That's a roundup of stuff to know about right now in the game, what Bungie are tracking, as well as that brief roadmap and things to be aware of going into the new year and the new content that we'll get over the next few weeks' time. Now though, to reflect on this year in general, it has been a pretty interesting one. I was browsing Google earlier on, I saw a Polygon article entitled 2018 has been Destiny 2's best and worst year. I hadn't really thought about it that way, but it has definitely been the case. Of course, after D2's launch and then Curse of Osiris, things definitely got rough for Destiny 2, and to be honest, I think the worst of that was probably January and February of this year, or of 2018, of course, you may be watching this video in 2019. But yeah, once we actually hit a content lull, the earlier part of this year was definitely rough, and then of course we did have the March update, which did bring a bunch of sandbox changes, and we kind of teetered along, didn't we, until we got to the Warmind expansion. Despite the huge efforts of Forsaken in September, I do feel like Warmind was kind of the beginning of the turning point for the game. The way they adjusted kind of power leveling in the game, the exotic quests that we got, as well as collectibles in the world and Mars in general, it was definitely a few steps closer to the kind of content that we always really wanted in Destiny. I think for players who had continued playing Destiny throughout Curse of Osiris and the early parts of this year, Warmind was definitely a very positive experience for the game at the time, and plus we kind of knew that Bungie would come out in September with something even bigger. And of course, through the summer, we started to see Forsaken. And honestly, that's been pretty recently. The one thing I would say about Forsaken is that for hardcore players of Destiny, it's definitely kind of brought the game back to life. I would personally 100% say that Forsaken is one of the best content drops that Destiny as a franchise has ever had. But of course, it doesn't come without its own issues. I think the roughest part of Forsaken probably has been the overall grind, but especially for things like the economy, the ability to infuse various materials, enhancement cores, more specifically, exotic drop rates. I think it's definitely been kind of a point of frustration for all types of players, you know, whether you're a hardcore player and you want to max out that collection and then look for decent rolls on exotics, or whether you're a little more casual and it's difficult to put a ton of time into the game, and then of course you're left without actually getting these things dropped whatsoever. I'd say those have been kind of the pain points for Destiny 2, and now we're in this interesting spot where Bungie are trying a completely different model. And let's face it, Black Armory has definitely had mixed opinions. I feel like Forges and the loop in Black Armory in general is definitely positive for the game, but once again, certain elements are too grindy. It kind of falls to Bungie to find that perfect balance now, you know? I think they're making generally decent content, and it does look like Season of the Drifter is going to address quite a few pain points that we have been speaking about for a while. And it'll also be interesting to see how Bungie handles that, with that being kind of a mid-year release for the game. And this is going to be like 6-7 months after Forsaken, so I'm definitely curious to see how much Bungie will hype it up, how much content is going to be there. But let me know your thoughts about it down below, guys. I'm still personally enjoying Destiny quite a bit. And if Bungie keep their eye on that quality threshold that they set with Forsaken and make sure that everything they release can try and be as close to that as possible, and also make sure that they're responding to feedback, you know, some of the current issues in the game, It's never good when we end up waiting 6 months for something to change, you know? Overall, though, I'm feeling pretty positive about Destiny's future, but guys, let me know what you think down below. Safe to say that 2018 has been a rocky year for Destiny 2, but let's hope for a positive year in 2019. So guys, have an absolutely awesome new year. Thank you so much for all of the support you've shown me here on the channel this year. It's been absolutely insane. Without a doubt, it has been my most exciting year on YouTube, so thank you guys so much for making that possible. However, guys, that is going to summarize the video once and for all. So whatever you get up to, I hope you have an awesome new year. Yeah.